Dear State President Dr. Narayanan, National Vice President Dr. Ananda Keshavan, past National President Dr. Sachidananda Kamath, guest of the day, speaker of the day, respected Vijayashekaran sir, my dear teachers and dear friends, today is the TED talk of Beyond Horizon Meet the Domains series, and today's session is by Dr. Vijayashekaran sir. He is from Chennai. We all know the respiratory subspecialties, but that from the Chennai, and he was the one of the pioneer who nurtured this pediatric subspecialty, and he is the great contribution is the popularization of the bronchoscopy in children. Many of the persons in this group, including Dr. Narayan, was taught by him, my colleague Dr. Jayakrishnan, and many of us, including Krishna Mohan, Suresh, bronchoscopy was taught by him, not only in Kerala or in South India, across the India. With all due respects and regards, on behalf of IAP Kozhikode and on behalf of IAP Kerala, I welcome you, sir, to this Zoom meeting. I also welcome our State President Narayanan, Secretary Bala, our past Secretary General of Central IAP, Dr. Ramesh, past National President, Dr. Sachidananda Kamath, who will chair this session, and all my respected teachers and friends, and also my organizing team, including Dr. Narayanan, Dr. Bala, Dr. Ramesh, Dr. Vijay Kumar, Dr. Krishna Mohan, Dr. Renjit, and Dr. Nihas. And I already said this session is chaired by Dr. Sachidananda Kamath, the past National President of IAP, who has contributed much to the organization. We all know, he will always say IAP, the three main objectives: academics, then social, one more, I forget that, he will say that. academics, advocacy. And during his tenure, the transparency has come to the organization. He introduced electronic voting during his tenure. And in the inaugural day of this series, our national president said he is the national president who contributed much to the corpus fund of the IAP, or as well as the space, the building of the IAP. That is, Kamath sir is an organizational man from bottom to top. On behalf of IAP Calicut, with a lot of love and regard, I welcome you, sir, to chair this session. I welcome all others. Before going to the chair, I invite our State President, Dr. Narayanan, for President's remarks.
Yeah. Good evening to you all, Dr. Ashraf, Dr. Kamath, JR, sir, senior pediatricians, and my dear friends. Today I have the privilege of having my teacher, Vijayashekaran sir, for the talk. I recall the days about three decades ago, in the late 80s and early 90s, when I was doing my post-graduation there, the trio, Professor Somu sir, Vijayashekaran sir, and Balayadri sir, they were the kings of pediatric pulmonology in South India. At that time, there was no other center in South India doing bronchoscopy. And maybe at the national level, there were only a few centers. So that was a teaching center, teaching point, training point for all the pediatricians in South India. And I remember the number of cases he was doing. Now it is crossed 6,000 cases. And so many of us have benefited from his training. And so many patients have also benefited. Is a real doyen of pediatric pulmonology. And one thing, I think if you are doing bronchoscopy, you never get old. because at that time also he was young man. Now also he appears to be a very young man. So it's a pleasure to have you, sir, here, and wish you all a very useful, enjoyable webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Shall I proceed, sir?
Thank you. I invite Dr. Ananda Keshavan for the inaugural remarks.
So very good evening, President Dr. Narayanan, Secretary Dr. Bala, past National President Dr. Sachi Kamath, today's chief guest Dr. Vijay Sagaran, IEP office base of Calicut and Kerala, my dear friends, teachers and colleagues. It's very happy to see that the IEP Kozhikode program is going very nicely and with more and more participation. I think bronchoscopy in pediatric pulmonology means in Kerala is not well developed. The centers are doing bronchoscopy, I think still in a infancy stage, but more and more young generation are coming under the leadership of Dr. Vijay Sagaran as expert. As such, Vijay Sagaran is he is the most popular person regarding bronchoscopy in South, not only in South India, as Ashraf mentioned, all over India. And also our association with Vijay Sagaran is a very long association with Vijay Sagaran and the Chennai team, Balayandar and others. I wish the program all the success and thank you. Thank you very much. Jai Hind, Jai IEP.
I invited Dr. Ramesh Kumar, who is the coordinator of the scientific committee of this program, for the remarks. Ramesh.
Respected President Dr. Ashraf sir, State President Dr. Narayan, Dr. Sachi, Dr. President, National President, State Secretary Bala, National Vice President Dr. Ananda Keshavan, Chief Guest of the Day, Vijay Sagaran sir, seniors in the was around our office bearer of IEP Kerala and IEP Kozhikode. My respectful regards as well as good evening. We are going IEP Calicut with this, the doyens of pediatrics and pediatric series. We have got the seven personalities catering to the academics of needs of the IEP fraternity. And about Vijay Sagaran sir, it's like something like I believe 15 to 20 years back only Sukumaran sir, our mentor in IEP Kerala, he only introduced Vijay Sagaran sir to ICH Kottayam and other where I was based most degree around Kottayam. I've seen him, I couldn't have because bronchoscopy was something beyond our dreams that day. But he was coming to ICH, the Kottayam Medical College, Institute of Child Health and doing some bronchoscopy workshops. And thereafter it was like, it is just like he was a pioneer and he was the ultimate word in bronchoscopy. And as Dr. Narayan has put it, was experienced straight away as a student. The trio was there in Chennai and the pediatric pulmonology was based in Chennai. And right now also I believe your legacy is continued by Gauri Shankar, Shobhalen and all the Ramayandran sir, the entire team. And that's how we are so much enthused about bronchoscopy. And last year in Central IAP, we had a right going giant strides in pediatric endoscopy where Dr. Pallav and others, we had a lot of training workshops under with the Olympus team. So that's, we believe that previously bronchoscopy was beyond the reams of the ordinary pediatrician. Now we have got a lot of trained hands around and we now got to refer any case. You know, we have more cases now being identified to be referred to a pediatric pulmonologist or a bronchoscopy. So that has been the strength has set me by Vijay Sagaran sir, and now he can hear from the horse's mouth itself what exactly are the basics as well as the news in bronchoscopy. And congratulations again to IEP Kozhikode and IEP Kerala, Narayan Bala team plus Ashraf, the Nihas team and all others for arranging this wonderful series. And my core team in Kozhikode, Dr. Vijay Kumar and the others who are arranging this webinar series in a big way. And our chairperson is Dr. Sachi is here and he is about to guide us in a big way in this webinar here today. Okay, best wishes to the meet today.
Thank you, Dr. Ramesh. Now we are moving on to the scientific session. Vijay Sagaran sir will talk on bronchoscopy in pediatric pulmonology, an overview. I invite Dr. Sachidananda Kamath to chair the session.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ashraf, our State President, Dr. Narayanan, Calicut branch president Dr. Ashraf, chief guest, and my dear friend Dr. Vijayashekharan, other office bearers, and vice president and the chief guest of the day Dr. Ananda Keshavan, other office bearers of the state, as well as team Calicut, who have led this to a very big way in the whole of the country. It's with proud privilege that I am introducing my good friend Dr. Professor D. Vijayashekharan. His biodata runs in pages, but I don't know how to go through that pages, but to put it short, I would say that currently he is the pediatric pulmonologist in Apollo Hospital and Kanji Kamarodi Child Trust Hospital. He was formerly the professor of pediatrics and pulmonology in Madras Medical College. He had delivered 3 orations, prestigious orations, that is Dr. N. Soma oration in 2014, Dr. H. Paramesh oration in 2011, and Dr. Jayaraj Iyengar oration at 2010. He has published the book on flexible fibro-optic bronchoscopy in children, one of the book which is referred by almost all the pulmonologists in the country. As an organizational person, he has held various posts in the IAP as well as the respiratory chapter, and he was the chairperson of respiratory chapter in 2017-18, which he could have taken it up much, much earlier than where I was the secretary in 2000 in the respiratory chapter. Regarding the bronchoscopies, if Guinness Book of Records knows that there is a person who has performed more than 600, that will be the Vijayashekharan. Dr. Vijayashekharan, if you take it up, he has trained bronchoscopy for the more than 10,000 pediatrician or the general or the PGs or anybody.
Keep continuing everything. Our efforts are continuing. Our work is.
That's right. So for the bronchoscopy, and if we ask him to do a full day session or 3 days or 7 days, he will do it. Now
7 days. 7 days course.
And apt thing is that it is given as overview only. That I congratulate the team Calicut for choosing this topic of bronchoscopy in pediatric pulmonology, and overview, when to refer, where to refer, what to be done. And
hello,
Kamath sir, you are muted now, Kamath sir. Please unmute in your device, Kamath sir. Yeah.
Yes.
Again, you are muted. Please unmute. Kamath sir, you are muted now. Whether we are going to Vijayashekharan sir?
Yes.
Kamath sir.
Yeah. If he is ready, you will start the program with the. You can just put your stories through the chat box, and Ashraf will be looking into that chat box and will be discussing in the last of his talk. Over to you, Dr. Vijayashekharan.
Yes, sir. Any question, you please post it to the chat box. Myself and Krishna Mohan will read it after the end of the session. Okay, sir, over to you.
Yes, sir, thank you for your kind words. I think I really thrilled the way in which you all introduced me. And we'll now go to the slides, because when I saw the program, I was really delighted. I first of all want to say hello, as well as my wishes to all the organizers. Dr. Kamath is there, and Dr. Sachi Kamath, I know him very long time, and other people also, Ramesh, Ashraf, all I want to say hello, particularly Dr. Krishnamohan and all. I think when I saw the program, I really delighted the galaxy of speakers from all over India. I think I also want to contribute something. I welcome you all. I think before my starting my bronchoscopy, I like to tell you, I think these are the very hard days. You have to protect yourself first. I think you know much better than me. And I think there are two types of audience. One is a case discussion, because for a general practitioner, if I talk too much about bronchoscopy, it will be very bored. What if I want to balance in such a way that case discussions is very, very interesting. All of you can join with me. And for a audio ready, that means it's a questions given to some of the pulmonologists who are doing a bronchoscopies. For example, I am keeping 5 discussion. In between 5 discussion, I am also having 5 quiz questions. I think in that way, it will be very interesting for you and all. Let us start with one. Actually, this has happened. Actually, the child is brought from Pondicherry. 2-year-old child. Actually, when I saw the child, I really because he lost her father very recently. And that the child has been treated for a long time with homeopathy. And because look at this scenario. Recurrent respiratory infection since birth, stunted growth, wheeze, nebulizer, admission. And this is the X-ray chest. I think actually X-ray chest totally spoiled. This X-ray I had taken from some of my video. And actually these are the problems. I don't have growth stunted. There is a hemithorax, is very opaque, and the mediastinal shift is there. Is it a collapse, consolidation, dextral? It's a really tough case to mind when you see the X-ray and all. And how to actually, I am being a teacher, I always want to give some thing, because there are a lot of PGs will be there. When you go for X-ray, don't upset, because X-ray is still, I am one of the excellent tool. When I take my PG classes, I always say, when you start interpreting X-ray, look at 6 points, 6 strike rule. I always say like that. I think, look at the mediastinum, lung fields. I think how to remember, that's a problem. Even if it is, you will forget it. So you always remember the borders of the mediastinum first. I think start how the right bottom, left bottom. Right bottom is only every SVC and right atrium. Whereas the right ventricle is the one that forms the inferior border. I think this everybody knows that. And the left border is formed by aorta, pulmonary artery, left atrial appendage, and all this. I think when you start seeing X-ray, only 2 sets, you have to make 3 vertical lines and a very horizontal, 2 horizontal lines, 3 horizontal lines. For example, vertical lines, first one starts in the mediastinum, because you learn a lot with that if you follow this. First line is starting in the mediastinum, second one is the lung fields, third one is the soft tissue. Don't change it. You follow this. And 3 horizontal lines are that such that one is through the epiphysis, one is through the hilum, and one is through the angles. If you follow this, I don't think so you miss that. And with this background, we'll see what is happening. I am putting a straight away. Normal mediastinum is such that 1/3 in the right side and 2/3 on the left side. And this condition, so there are some or push and all. Actually, this is the condition. Which are the conditions that pull the mediastinum? Actually, if you remember that, it can very easily interpret the X-rays. One is the collapse, pleural thickening, hypoplasia. I think among the 4, the child should come. Okay? And see that there is a opaque, there is a shift of the mediastinum to the right, dextrocardia. And if you go there, among the 4, it may not be fitting into collapse, because collapse is always a wedge shape and there is a no past history, so there is no pneumonia at all. It's not a bronchopneumonia, left up with only hypoplasia. So with this background, actually the child has come to me. I want to see whether it's a really hypoplasia or something more than that, and what is happening to the child and all. So what I thought, I done a bronchoscope. I did not be showing all the bronchoscope, because it takes, you quickly see the bronchoscope. All the bronchoscope is, see, it's a trachea. Even the tracheal margins, you look at that, Anybody, if you answer before I finish, I think you are really a bronchoscopist, because many of our colleagues have already seen that. I am going like that, but what I am not seeing is, I am not able to see the carina. That's a problem. If I am not able to see the carina, what is the diagnosis? Okay, this is the diagnosis. See, normal carina should be like this, okay? Normal carina, how nicely there is a two hollow things. Whereas what I have seen is that this one. See, my bronchoscopist are ready to answer, what is this? Because one day you'll be also seeing like that, this is nothing but the agenesis of the right lung. Okay, agenesis of the right lung. Actually, the child comes with a right opaque hemithorax on the right side, mediastinal shift up. Actually, the bronchoscope shows that the trachea continues as the right bronchus without any carina, and there is the trachea continues as a left main bronchus, and without there is a carina, so it is a agenesis of the right lung and all. Okay, so this agenesis hypoplasia complex is a very big chapter. I don't want to get, but books are all, it's very confusing. It's, see, what you see there, you have to look at the, whether it's a bronchus is there or lung is there. If both are there, it is hypoplasia. Only thing is, this is only a reduced number. Whereas the agenesis, both will be absent. Actually, there is no bronchus, there is no lung. And in between, there is a aplasia and all. I think this is a very, very great subject, because most of the time when you come across hypoplasia, not the agenesis, this child is actually 12-year-old child. You can ask me how the 12-year-old child is and all. But if you go into that, these are the agenesis, hypoplasia, everything looks same thing as that. And I don't want to go to that thing further. Only thing is, look at the CT. If you see the hypoplasia, you can see the lung here. Okay, can you see the lung here? This is what the hypoplasia. Whereas in agenesis, you cannot see the lung. And again, there is a volume also has been maintained, because agenesis happened much earlier than hypoplasia. That is what very funny things. If you look at the embryo, see the what agenesis happened in the embryonic period, that is 3 to 6 weeks. Whereas even atresia, stenosis, all these things, they're all happened while the lung is forming in the form of a bronchial bud and all. Actually, there is actually what they say that in agenesis, it is an absent pulmonary vasculature is a cause for agenesis of the lung and all. But what is happening in the pulmonary aplasia? Aplasia is happened much later in the chronic analytical period, where the history of oligohydramnios is very, very important. So, to summarize, this is a child presenting with the absence of bronchus, parenchyma, and vessel. Actually, what they say, 50% of them will die 5 years. But any child who lives after 5 years, I can see in the net or the anecdote says that even one old man living up to 72 years, that's also possible. That is the reason why don't think agenesis means we lose it. If we make the child to live normally, you have to protect them to away from the infection. And these are the rates of infection. We have to know how to protect the very common infection like influenza and pneumococcal infection. And if you know the hygiene and with the regular vaccine, they will After one case discussion, my friends or some people are watching this. Actually, they are very bronchoscopists like me. They have done a lot of bronchoscope. One quiz for you. I think, I don't know how many people will all answer all the quiz. One quiz in between the discussion. Can you see that? Okay. Can you see that very quickly? It's a very interesting case. This boy looks very normally. How he is being laughing at you, know? Do you think that he is suffering from any disease? Okay. But look at the X-ray. X-ray is what? That is a shift of the mediastinum to the left, and I have done a bronchoscope. Can you see what is happening? That there is a foreign body in the left main bronchus, okay? And that is causing the shift of the mediastinum and hyperaeration and all these things. That is a very, very common that actually if anybody is detected, that's a foreign body. The another question is, what is the commonest foreign body? Okay? 80% of the foreign bodies in our setup, what they say, it's due to the PNET. Okay? though it commonly occurs below 3 years, it can be possible up to 5 years. So any unexplained respiratory symptoms, think of the foreign body. That is what that. But don't think that foreign body can be removed by fiber flexible bronchoscope. Actually, only a very trained persons can attempt that. But best way is, the safest way is, still as a flexible man doing a lot of bronchoscope, as a regional bronchoscope is the treatment of choice. Okay, I think past history should never be ignored. We'll go to the second case, because there are 5 cases. We have to go very fast, very fast and all. This is the second case for you. This is a 5-month-old, 5 kg only, presenting with both the symptoms, stridor and wheeze. Okay, it is a neonatal admission, and his child also having hypoxic spelling at all. Admitted 3 times. Okay, this is an X-ray. It's been extensively investigated 3 times in the hospital, and actually this means nothing more than anybody will treat this as a GRD with a pneumonia. That is what the thing. With this picture, they came to us because the child is the first child is come from a very poor family. This opposite to that, this 5-month-old male baby is from a very affluent group. Actually, they themselves the owner of a very big hospital in a big city in India. I don't want to tell that. And this vascular ring is the one they suspected, including tracheobronchomalacia, subglottic stenosis, TF. These are the differential diagnosis they made, and they come to us and all. Okay, and I think I also thought it could be one of that with that, and I always say your noises will teach you. In a child suffering from snoring, always think of adenoid. Stetter is always in the pharyngeal sound that goes with the neurologically problem child and all. Stridor is always happening either in the upper trachea or the larynx, and wheeze is the one either in the lower trachea or the bronchi. They all, this is a very, very fundamental teaching, but this child having a wheeze and other things and all. Okay, this child having a wheeze and other things and all. Okay, I show the video just to see that. I think really it's happened in last November. Actually, when I saw that, since the first time I am seeing that, I myself have my own doubt. Am I missing any tumor or something like that? Then I keep on looking at the video again and again. And finally, okay, this is a, okay, what you're seeing is a small mucosal bulge. Okay, mucosal bulge, and that is also, it's something look like a cyst or something look like a hemangioma for me. Okay, it is happening in the anterior wall of the trachea. Actually, when I saw that, really first time, it's really after so much bronchoscope, I also puzzled. And okay, so with this background history, there is a cyst-like mucosal lesion seen at the upper of the anterior wall of the trachea. I given 2 differential diagnoses, namely mucosal cyst and hemangioma. That is what possible. Then we have a discussion, and we have a very eminent ENT surgeon with us, and we combine our bronchoscopes, and finally along with the flexible, they done a rigid bronchoscope just to see what he is doing. Very nice. We have initially had a big discussion whether to, and we got the permission from the director and all. Finally, what we thought, we just pierce is the mucosal bulge. Okay, after piercing it, there is a lot of fluid has come out that, and that gives a hope that it could be a case of something like a cyst. Okay. And the ENT surgeon didn't meddle much, and he just removed the fluid. After that, the next day itself, the child's problem, including noise as well as the wheeze and everything, is settled down, and we left the child. Okay, that is what. Okay, these were the very, very interesting case for me, because these are all not reported in the book. Okay, the book means what all you write only. This is still, I am seeing that whether such a mucosal cyst is possible in the trachea, at what level, and all these things and all. Okay, I think now our bronchoscopy friends are there. Are you ready? I'll show you one quick bronchoscopy video, and people who started doing bronchoscopy can help you, can come up with the answer. Okay, I think this I shown in many places with the background. You quickly see this. I show only the video. What is this? What is happening? My friends are there. They are looking at. I think people who are doing a lot of bronchoscope like me, they would have come across that. And once see this, because very typically cysts are happening. Though it is in a piriform fossa or varicular fossa, I seen 3 or 4 cases. This cyst. What is this? How to call it? This cyst is somewhere between epiglottis and the posterior base of the tongue. Can you agree with me? And if anybody answered that, this is a cyst, varicular cyst, you are correct. Okay. And only thing is, it is sitting in a very place, and because of the mass effect, the child is not able to breathe properly, developing a respiratory distress and vomiting and hypoxemic feature in between. Actually, sometimes we can pick up with the MRI and all, but only thing is after the bronchoscope only, we can, even myself putting a bronchoscope, just I usually pass the nasopharynx, then the pharynx. When I reach the pharynx, I'm able to see that we make a diagnosis, and immediately in a small mass supervision, small surgical procedure, we made the child all right. The child has been so much failure to thrive because of the repeated vomiting and hypoxia. They are becoming all right with a simple surgical procedure and all. Okay, this second phase is over. Many people will have answered because we already discussed that cases. Now we'll go for a very typical case, third case. Okay, it is a 7-year-old boy admitted in the hospital. Actually, it's a very blood tinged. Past 3 months, he is having a blood tinged sputum. Actually, sometimes he had a dry cough, sometimes shortness of breath, sometimes fever. He been repeatedly given some course of antibiotics. Actually, child also started with ATT. That's what the funny thing. And I saw another report is hemoglobin is 0.2, and his smear is showing macrocytic hypochromic anemia picture, and even gastric lavage has done that is negative. Even a hemoglobin hydroxylation order. With this background, anything strike to your mind is a 7-year-old. Why just to give them hemoptysis, that is a blood tinged sputum with the shortness of breath with anemia. I think the should patients very quickly made a very calculation. Any child presented with hemoptysis, anemia, shortness of breath, only thing is what we need is we have some x-rays. Look at the x-rays. We had a 3 x-rays, the shadowing is appears to be clearing at some point of time and reappearing, but it's so diffuse, it occupying the entire chest and all. I think such a picture is very typically goes with that. Anybody got answer with you? Okay. Even the CT shows that there is a ground glass opacification. With this, we almost come to the diagnosis. Only thing is we have a confirmation because we had these differential diagnoses starting from good posture, vaginas, rheumatoid, inner, and idiopathic pulmonary emphysema. So these are the differential diagnoses we thought in our mind. Good posture is unlikely because there is no proteinuria, and actually hemoptysis also is not that much very big at all. Vaginous granulomatosis, I think it is a condition, it is a small vessel disease with the granulomatous disease, and the child presenting with the both upper and lower airway problem, and even sometimes go for a subglottic stenosis and all rhinitis. It's something like a picturing with the asthma, allergic rhinitis, so many things, but that is all not there. Rheumatoid arthritis is completely removed because there is no knee problem. And I think one condition I want to say that cow's milk induced pulmonary disease. I think in my experience, I'm honestly saying that I want to share this. I have made this diagnosis about 5 to 8 people. I remember 5 people in the last 3 years, and totally it may be around 8 people and all. Because cow's milk also supposed to produce this sort of, because IgE or sometimes it may be a non-IgE response, and sometimes that syndrome is called Heener syndrome, and this particular group is very well known and stopping the milk, stopping the cow's milk, make the child better and all. So we plant broncol lavage because the child has already been there. The lavage is such that slightly bloodstained and all, and we get the child for a porous Prussian blue stain. Actually, there is a confusion. Some people will know this as a porous stain. Some people will know Prussian blue stain. Actually, always write porous Prussian blue stain and all. That is a better word because some clinical pathologists are very knowledgeable about only one particular word and all. So you are staining. That is a Prussian blue staining shows such a picture that is showing that hemosiderin gland macrophages, and it goes with IPH, idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis. Now we are all very happy, but only thing is it's a really bad condition because I still remembering Dr. Kabra published a very big report from the Indian scenario how IPH is very common, the primary and secondary and all. If anybody interested, this is one of the Kabra's best article. I can quote that one. But what I want to say that ball, that is a broccoli alavar, is a very useful one because many staining techniques like soda, oil red staining, or what I said is a pearl stain or Prussian blue, or even a KOH stain. Sometimes silver stain is used for pneumocystis jervis stain and a periodic acid stain for allelar proteinase. Why I'm telling is, if you know that only if you suspect some disease, you have to talk well with the clinical pathologist, what you want to that. If you're looking for a particular diagnosis like Langerhans or histiocytosis, then we should discuss with the clinical pathologist or a microbiologist, what are you looking for? CD1 positive cells in the BL. Like that, hypocyst pneumonitis, a proportion of CD8 will be more. Eosinophilia, if it is more than, you can suspect eosinophilic syndrome. And in allelar proteinosis, it appears very, very milky protein. Actually, it's a very bad disease. Once you find out, you have to go for therapeutic allelar lavage and other things and all. So the child is finally made the diagnosis of IPH, idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis. And we know that actually the prognosis is slightly very bad with the child. Of late, somewhat improved. And most of the times, we use with the intermittent steroid or immunosuppressant agents like azithromycin, or in my, I use hydroxychloroquine. We all know today hydroxychloroquine is very widely talked with the corona days. I think world over, I think it's a wonderful drug. I'm not telling about the so COVID in the construct, that's a really little, you have to settle, last word is not finalized. But anyway, this very good drug, I'm telling that in my days, I have treated many ILD. Myself, along with Dr. Gavishankar and Dr. Sivabalan, I think we all work together, and we have a large collection of ILDs. And many of them, after inhaled steroids, they have been responding to hydrochloroquine. Or sometimes, even inhaled corticosteroids is going to be very helpful. I think my bronchoscopy people are there. Are you ready? Can you go for the third piece? Already, many people are answered very correctly. I am seeing that. So, because I have shown only a very, 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 I don't want to show you very tough things because other people may not like it. Now we'll go to the third piece. Are you ready? I'll show that. Okay, right. See that I am going the bronchoscope through the this one, vocal cords with the trachea. Normal trachea is appearing like a tunnel, very nice and all. But normally we should have a two opening. Okay, that is a carina. What you are seeing? Is there a two opening or more than that? I think once you see that, you may not forget. See, some fluid is coming out of the opening. Some gushes of air also is coming and all. What is that? Anybody and all? Okay, that's some gushes and all. So I think already you made a diagnosis. Some people are sending me. And okay, what is this? Anybody? I think this is nothing but tracheal bronchus. Pig's bronchus. I think any particular child is having a right upper lobe problem, either in the form of persistent pneumonia or collapse or recurrent pneumonia involving the right upper lobe, think tracheal bronchus, otherwise it's called as Pig's bronchus. Sometimes not necessary to go with the bronchoscopy because don't think that bronchoscopy is not a final way, final answer to that. Sometimes even MDCT, that is multidirectional temperature, MDCT itself will give an answer to that. And why I'm telling you is, if you do not diagnose streptococcal bronchus, you unnecessarily deem this as an unresolved or persistent pneumonia involving the right upper lobe. So today, you remember that anything that is not clearing for a long time in the right upper lobe, think of that. We'll go to the third case discussion and all. I think so quickly I can show that this is a child comes from a deep south of Tamil Nadu. Already in the first admission, they made a diagnosis of colon consolidation because they done extensively starting from rigid bronchoscopy to CT and all. Okay, this is the time they visited me with the X-ray. I'll show the X-rays little later and all. Second admission is mine. I thought because it's a 5-month-old baby. Sorry, 4-month-old baby. When come to that, I completed this investigation suspecting vascular ring, but they don't want to say for more than 48 hours. But at the time, I only made the child because it's so sick looking, distressed. I corrected all these things, but I advised to come after some time. After 4 weeks, they returned back. The third admission, but an echo, but there is no vascular ring, but there is a lot of lymph nodes, and report says that maybe evolving tumor or PID and all. Actually, they are worried. Actually, they went back and again come after 3 weeks. Finally, fourth admission, I myself repeated the bronchoscopy second time because first time, but in a bronchoscopy, the child was very sick, and I myself doubted about the findings and all. So this is the findings of the second bronchoscopy, and you quickly see that the bronchoscopy is going inside, and you can see is something the trachea itself being compressed by the nodes from outside. That's what I can say with that. And okay, and this thing, if we go down on the right bronchus, can you see it? So it's a granulation tissue. Okay, and that made me think, and I asked the parents, is there any contact with the tuberculosis in the family? Because they said no and all. And finally, I made a confidence. Somehow after third or fourth visit, they started that what I am talking is a real meaning, and they are telling about it. They are telling about the contact in the in-laws. There is a father's father, a grand. There is a like grandfather. Okay. So bronchoscopy made endobronchial diagnosis. There is endobronchial tuberculosis, and I think something like opposite to Savarcheek intrathoracic trachea. Actually, that is what seen COPD and all, but that is not so with that. And it's a granulation tissue. But then a bronchoalveolar, but bronchoalveolar is excellent thing. Immediately, CV detected that is a TB, microvascular tuberculosis. That is what advantages with the CV net. Okay, CV net. I think you can do. Why I am showing this bronchoscopic appearance of endobronchial TB is endobronchial TB appears in a very varying form. Sometimes it may be caseinating, nodular, ulcerative, tumorous. All these things being recorded, I think it's beyond our discussion. And what I want to say is, as a common man, when you got a sample, I think CBNAT, cortic based nucleic acid implication, is a very, very useful one. That is what is commonly known as gene expert. But only thing is, we can have a drug sensitivity only for rifamycin and INH. Other drug sensitivity we cannot find out. That's the reason why, when you strongly suspect in tuberculosis, we have to go for some other liquid culture also. This is a gene expert. If digits as low as 131, that is 131 bacilli. Whereas the newer one that is called Ultra Expert MTB. Have you heard about that Ultra Expert? Actually, even WHO has agreed and is approved that this can be used, and many many places Ultra Expert MTB is available. One advantage is it detects as low as 16 bacilli per. For example, smear means we need to have 10,000 bacilli. For example, that is a gene expert means 130 bacilli, whereas it detects as low as 16 bacilli. That is very, very advantageous and all. And this is a very, very important, this one. Why I'm telling you is, if you suspect tuberculosis, you always get the liquid culture. The liquid culture sometimes, because you can use this one also. What is that? BACTEC. But that BACTEC is the one that act a lot of radioactive hazards. That is the reason why. Otherwise, both are same. But if it is not available, you can go for BACTEC. Otherwise, go for MIGIT. in its liquid culture system, and actually the growth of the bacilli called depletion of auxin that can be sensed by a fluorescent, and in that way it detects the presence of bacilli. Blind probe assay is not necessary for routinely. When you have a suspected a drug resistant TB, you can go for blind probe assay, and if it is not available, that can be used. And I think with this we'll go for one more quiz, because I want to balance a common audience, general practitioners, as well as my own colleagues who have done a lot of bronchoscope and all, because they come with what is new and all. I'll show one more scenario. Only thing is, while the video is going on, you have to give me the answer. Okay, that is what the thing and all. Okay, can you see that? What you are seeing? You have to quickly find out what is that. That anterior wall is comes and touching the posterior wall. Okay, anterior wall comes and touching the posterior wall. What is this? It's a very very common condition. I want to say that has been treated under the umbrella of recurrent VS in the infancy. It's very sorry to say that in many places I think this has been totally missed, because in all my lectures, not only me, my bronchoscopy team, entire team, now they're all convinced that any child who have been repeatedly admitted below 1 year of age in various hospital, we have to rule out what is this. Okay, this is a normal trachea. Okay, this is a trachea malacia. Look at that. Normal trachea is supported by the cartilage and the muscle so nicely like a tunnel, whereas here the miss and this cartilage is been defective, so it has been compressed like that, that make the child to go for collapse. So in early malacia, maybe tracheomalacia, bronchomalacia, or tracheobronchomalacia, actually the contour is maintained only by the smooth muscle. That's the reason why if you use beta agonist like a salbutamol, already it is compliant, it become more compliant, more collapsible. Then this might be worse. Mother may be telling, sir, after that salbutamol nebulization, my child is not all right, becoming more worse and all. So better you try with this ipratropium bromide, or try along with that some good amount of postural drainage. I think along with the antibiotic postural drainage with ipratropium without beta agonist, the child may started improving and all. I think look at what Gina says. Any child presenting or suspected as an asthma or recurrent wheeze, it is not only recurrent viral infection, GER, foreign body, think about tracheobronchomalacia. That is what Gina says, and this being given in your Nelson also. Okay, after that quiz, we'll go for the another important case discussion. I think this very quickly, I already shown somewhere, this boy is a 7-year-old boy, treated asthma 7 years without any spirometry and all. Bilateral hyperoid studies come from northeast, this is an X-ray, but CT showed some coin-like lesion, but it's not a coin. Okay, then this is a bronchoscope. This I have shown that only thing is, with this, we cannot come to any conclusion. We can say that it is a mass. Okay, some mass lesion sitting and coming from the anterolateral wall of the trachea. That is what we can say that, and that is what we have find out. After that, we form a very big team. I always join with my colleagues, particularly the ENT colleague. And at that time, we had so fortunate that we got some expert from European country, and he is able to review that, and it is finally proved to be a case of spindle cell tumor. Okay, the biopsy proved, and it is a inflammatory myoblastic tumor. And how we have done it? We have done it with the laser. Okay, the laser, diode laser is the one that helps us, and this is a very high sounding. Why I am telling is, the days are changing. Sometimes before, we all thought that is only a diagnostic. Bronchoscopy means only a diagnostic. Now we are slowly moving out of the area, because we are wanting a smaller size bronchoscope. Okay, even the suction channel are becoming more and more. It is we are available. Even the small babies, we can have a 2.2 millimeter suction channel. So you can, and not that, but still, these procedures like EBUS, cryo biopsy, all these things can be possible only after 10 to 11 years or 12 years and all. But many people may be interested to know what is endobronchial ultrasound with the transbronchial needle aspiration. EBUS is one of the excellent technique. Those days we have a very blind needle aspiration and all these things. And here it's a very, very advanced technique. And any child with about 11 years suspected to having various lymph nodes or suspected sarcoidosis and all, you can do that. Actually, in India, you are on a, I think many centers, particularly in R&D Institute of Medical Sciences, they started doing. Even in Bangalore team is already doing that. And many people, because I'm very happy that youngsters should learn bronchoscopy. Once you do a bronchoscopy, you can go for further advances, because by the day, another 5 years, cryotherapy may be available. Actually, cryotherapy is one of the excellent technique, and what we use is liquid nitrogen. And sometimes it can be used to even extract the foreign bodies. That's what the great thing. But only thing is the size now. Probably a day may come, even a smaller size bronchoscope will allow cryotherapy needles, and we can do that and all. Okay, one more quiz for you. I think many people will be tired about the discussion. We'll go for one small bronco quiz. Okay, are you ready? How is this? So it is a simple one, because I want to show, because there are a lot of audience will be general practitioners or even pediatricians. But if you look at that, if you say that this is a thing, you are correct. You cannot be seeing that. What is that? What is happening there? I am seeing the vocal cord. I am seeing the movement of arytenoids. I am constantly showing the upper airway. The movement of vocal cords is very good. And what else is you are seeing? Anybody? Anybody? Okay. What is the movement? What is that? Actually, these are all happening once in a while, but still you can do that. Actually, what is that? Anybody shows that it's a foreign body. Actually, this boy is having a 3 foreign bodies who have been removed in 3 settings, because he has put a lot of peanuts, and I think once by remove, we thought something coming from the lower end, and that is why it's happened also. Why I'm telling is, peanut is a very, very common thing, and sometimes by removing a one nut, don't we think that you are happy, child may come up tomorrow, and that is the reason why you have to inspect that with the flexible bronchoscopy and all. Now the case discussion is such that we'll go with it. Can you see that? Okay, what is this? The child is having a Yogalakshmi, actually being repeatedly admitted, okay? And because I'm already reaching a very tough time, only thing is I want to say that it's a recurrent pneumonia. Look at the picture. There are so many conditions that cause recurrent pneumonia, but bronchoscopy showed pseudomonas, okay? Whenever there is a pseudomonas, there is a possibility of cystic fibrosis, because organism itself says what is underlying, okay? And whether it is a staphylococcus, think of chronic granulomatous disease, or hypermethylation associated with the syndromes, okay? That is the way pseudomonas is showing that it is maybe a candidate of cystic fibrosis, because we immediately done sweat chloride by a nanoduct, and cystic fibrosis, why I'm telling is, some of them, particularly fourth and fifth variety is considered to be the mild variety. And if you detect that, I think some children may live better. Only thing is, sweat chloride nanoduct is now available, and it is a commercial model. It costs little more than and a few lakhs. If you purchase that, you can start screening people with a recurrent respiratory infection, particularly with the malabsorption from the younger days. And anything chloride count is more than 60 is there. And actually, recurrent pneumonia is a very great subject. Last one more seminar will show that. Why I am telling is, it's a very interesting one. And I think these are very, it is not only for the general practitioners as well as for the very common man. In the whole discussion, actually, this 16-year-old boy from the Northeast actually is having a very big amount of hemoptysis 3 times. He admitted in 3 hospitals in Northeast. And finally, if history is suggestive of asthma, allergic rhinitis, INS, with this background, they thought it is a small vessel vasculitis, like a Schirch-Strauss syndrome. That's actually, look at the way of investigation. They completed almost all the investigation. The one thing about this boy is so knowledgeable. He, by heart, you know the investigation and the normal values and all. Okay, almost all the techniques, scopes are all done. And finally, they suspected thromboembolism, because the vascular surgeon suggested it's a thromboembolic problem and all. And they have started working on how to rule out pulmonary embolism. And these are the investigations they've done. And deep vein thrombosis by doing ultrasonography lower limbs and other thing, INR, and other things. Finally, they also want to rule out hypercoagulation by doing protein S and protein C and all. Actually, almost we finished everything and all. I think he came to us and I got that I am not happy with his right lower lobe. Done only CT repeated in multi-director CT and Ball has done the gene expert directed TV. Why I am telling is common things are all very, very common. Why? Because they done suspected embolism, but we suspected because when repeatedly asked some questions, they come up with the answer. And finally, this boy is joined some club. There are a lot of people suffering from a cough and all, and there is a contact and all. Why I'm telling is liquid media is a very, very important drug. And again, one more thing is after diagnosis of TB, you have to use the antitabulation, the stipulated thing. Go refer WHO dosage, it is little changed. And you also use 4 drugs initially for 2 months, followed by 3 drugs, not the 2 drugs, and has been changed to 3 drugs in the things and all. Okay, I think I am, Narayan is there, or Sachi Kamath is there, or Ashraf is there. I am almost coming to that. And only one more slide. I'll show that this is another boy. He's also from North. What he said is his description is such that he brings every time one bucket, half bucket of blood. Finally, I also thought it's a real problem, maybe TB and all, because we are all connected, we have done an investigative and all, and actually everything is done for them, and massive hemoptysis, and finally, gene expert also negative. This time it's not TB. At that boy, everybody thought embolism is TB. This time it is not TB. So we have a very combined discussion and all. Finally, we thought in the literature, one other condition is called Dilophosis disease. Actually, fitting to that, finally, we discussed with the vascular surgeon, and the vascular surgeon is embolized, and he is able to embolize the thing, right bronchial artery embolization is done. After that, there is stopped. The child become normal. He came for a review and all. Why I am telling you, bronchoscopy is a very great subject. I think all of you, because sometimes it go under the umbrella of different names. Means or Strider, they've been treated or repeated admission and all. It's a very simple technique. Many congenital anomalies can be diagnosed very early if you do that. And people, if you learn advanced techniques, you can go for a interventional bronchoscopy and all. With this, I thank the all the one, particularly our people from Calicut. They joined with the IAP, and Calicut IAP has joined with Kerala IAP, and they have done excellent job of conducting that. And bronchoscopy is also one of the signs. I think we have to do, it's not a very routine one, but still these signs to be learned by the youngsters. Only thing is, my suggestion is, you cannot learn the car by 60 years. What, Narayanan? You cannot learn a car by 60 years. You can learn the car only by the 20s or 30s. Okay, don't worry. But still, anybody is beyond, very, very, very eager to learn bronchoscopy. I think we are ready to teach you. Only is your enthusiasm and all. Thank you. Thank you, one and all, for the patient listening. Thank you very much.
Kamath sir. Please unmute yourself. Okay,
sir. Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thank you very much for Dr. Vijay Shagran. This is Vijay Shagran, who presented very, very nicely that whole of the overview from the point of the when to refer, how to refer, and what we have to expect from a bronchoscopy. And to the best of it is to the listeners or the persons who are listening this topic, from the general practitioners or to the pulmonologist also. That's covered everything other than everything that is foreign body, hemangioma, TB, tumor, cystic fibrosis, almost rare cases to the common cases, and how we can miss also sometimes some of the rare cases or some of the presentations which are not common, but common diseases. Thank you very much, Vijay Shagran. And I should say that he is a real teacher who has taught, I think, bronchoscopy, whole of the country. He might have taught most of the bronchopulmonologists who are doing bronchoscopy. Over to you, Dr. Ashraf.
Thank you, Kamath sir. Now topic is open for discussion. Vijayashankar sir, I have a doubt regarding the BAL in tuberculosis and gene expert in the bronchoalveolar lavage. During the national TOT, we had an impression that there are a lot of false positivity for the gene expert in the BAL. What is your comment on that?
I fully agree that because bronchoscopy means the cleaning technique itself is very, very important. See, bronchoscopy, the cleaning, the paramedical is undergoing 6 months training how to keep the bronchoscopy because it's a source of infection. See, every time bronchoscopy should be cleaned, personally, it has to be monitored by the bronchoscopist. Otherwise, in atypical mycobacteria may be there, that can be given in the smear as a positive and confuse you or not. But once gene expert is positive, that you have to take it in a big way. Sometimes if you miss it, still you have to suspect tuberculosis strongly. I think nothing wrong in repeating in that because I think this technology, see, many times some of the things are all done by the paramedical. There is something it may happen. So the only thing is you should depute somebody to look after the bronchoscope cleaning technique, sending the sample, collecting the sample. Otherwise, these sort of things may happen wrong. Ashraf, am I answering anything left out?
Yeah. Okay, sir. Now, Krishna Mohan.
Yes, sir.
Over to you. Any comments?
Okay. Okay, sir. Sir, first of all, thank you very much for that excellent session. There is one question in the chat box. Can I ask, sir? Hello, sir?
Yes, sir. Give the note.
Okay. In a child with multiple laryngeal papillomatosis, will bronchoscopy lead to dissemination? This is from the chat box.
Vijayashankar sir, please unmute yourself. Your device is muted.
Laryngeal papillomatosis is a very unfortunate condition. You know, some child may have single nodule where if you identify and you remove either a surgical or laser therapy, it may be all right. Sometimes it has a tendency to recur again and again. I think I still remember one child being, if your stridor is such that while sleeping, it will go here for so many places, noise. I think laryngeal, I think that it's caused by virus, and that is the reason why a laryngeal papilloma is one of them that the vaccine, that HPV virus, if your strong family history is there, and it is not only for a female child, even adult child may be given that cover also. And I am telling you, it's not luck. Some children, even with a single sitting of surgical resection, they become all right. And some children, I think they keep on recurring and all. But today, we have a laser. Laser technology is becoming very powerful. Only thing is, you should know who are your adult colleagues are doing laser. Okay? Laser is a costly effort. Nobody can purchase and keep it with you. You have to identify as a group. You have to call one day who is doing laser. Then he will give you a very broad the overview. What are the areas you can be benefited from the laser therapy? In that way, you can make such children's arm. But only thing is, as you rightly said, it may have a tendency to spread on all. That is the reason why cytophobia is a one antiviral is being used. And only thing is, you should have a very strong connection with the ENT colleague as well as the laser therapist and all. I could see a lot of people are joining now. And I can see that Hari Kumar, Balachandra, everything. Yes, Balachandra. Yes.
Okay, sir. There is one more question from Dr. Ajay. He is our pediatric intensivist. What is the usual sedation which you provide for awake bronchoscopy? What's your personal suggestion for the best ones?
Yes, that I think it all depends upon the skill of the anesthetist. I am telling you, skill of the anesthetist. Some anesthetists are giving some low anesthesia such that you can do the procedure in level 2. See, if you give a very deep anesthesia, I think we'll totally miss the bus. All dynamic lesions will be, you cannot even enter also. That's the reason why in my younger days, I started doing bronchoscopy only with the local anesthesia. Okay? Wherever possible, because local anesthesia is very, very good means. I am telling you, for example, if I come and touch only, you will be unhappy. You will cry. If I don't touch, if without touching, I go like that, you may not feel anything. That is what we do with the child. Most of the young infants are very easy to handle. Only thing is, they may not like adult. Only by smalls, you have to strain them, you have to wrap them in nice way and give good local anesthesia. Or sometimes you can use a very minimal, either a medazolam or it all depends upon the other conditions, other comorbidities. And you discuss with them, your anesthetist colleague, and you tell them, I want only a brief anesthesia. Sometimes if you are very, then you very easily they can anesthetize you. Or if you sometimes, if you cross, you can wait for some time. Sometimes the anesthesia effects will be gone. And you have to plan your situation. But best thing I was saying, if you want to rule out the dynamic lesions, do try to venture with local anesthesia. If you're not able to do it only, you can ask your ENT, your anesthetic colleague, to give you a very small anesthesia. I think all fentanyl, medazolam, or other things are all equally good. It all depends upon how they are, even ketamine, how they are propofol. All these things are all, I think some people are very confident with some anesthesia. I think it's only anesthetist topic. But if you're doing alone, I am also doing, there is no anesthesia. There is no another people. I'm having only my colleague with me and all. You have to be very careful. What I am telling is, wherever I go lectures nowadays, good, keep anesthetist along with you. Number one. If there is no anesthetist, keep a competent person who is able to secure the bronchoscope when you are doing a bronchoscope. Number three, don't venture bronchoscopy without that basic things and all. This is what I repeatedly tell them.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir. So next, one more question. What are the precautions you are supposed to take during the time of COVID, during bronchoscopy?
I think bronchoscopy, I got a call from somewhere and all. I think if it is a very, very, very important case, for example, foreign body or anything like that, go for a bronchoscopy. Otherwise, if it is going to be a diagnostic bronchoscopy and all, that also seems to be very, very demanding, you can do all the precautions because that CDC as well as WHO gives some guidelines what to be followed. While you do bronchoscopy, how you have to you wear your PPE, how you have to wear gloves as well as the goggles and everything and all. If everything is available, you can go. But only thing is, if it is not very urgent, postpone, and even I got very recently, and I thought they're able to manage, put on the situation for something, because bronchoscopy is only a diagnosis. All right, you are going to tell only thing, your treatment is going to help us. So whatever we talk, what is a probable diagnosis, you go along with that line, okay? And a time will come where you can send proper bronchoscopies and you also join with them and you can do that and all. Otherwise, if it is not mandatory, don't go there. And if it is mandatory, go with all the precautions as advised by WHO and CDC. It's very nicely given to go through that and all.
Okay, sir. Thank you. There are no more questions in the chat box. I think I will hand over to Ashraf, sir. Sir. Sir, your audio is muted.
I am always telling to others to unmute. Now, I am also in mute. Dr. Narayanan, anything to say?
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
For sharing your rare cases and common cases. It was a real experience for us. And in your series of more than 6,000 cases, apart from the anesthetic complications, what all problems were there so that the youngsters and the practicing people can know what are the precautions we should take?
Yes, I'll tell only three things. While you do bronchoscopy, a person who do bronchoscopy have to personally inspect every instrument, starting from pulse oximeter, suction, oxygen source, everything. You have to go and inspect. That is number one. Number two, while do bronchoscopy, proper anesthetization is very, very important. For example, for a nose ring, you can use a lignocaine gel, 2% or 4%. And below that, you can go for 1% lignocaine solution. And if you nicely spray upper airway, okay? And you can very easily go that and all. Don't venture, don't be hurried. Because if you put a lignocaine, it will take at least 1 or 2 minutes. You have to wait and that and. Number three, do bronchoscopy, hyperoxygenating a child. Initially, you give a lot of oxygen, make the child, because the child will stamina is such that they'll keep the oxygen for 2 or 3 minutes. So hyperoxygenate and do that. And the last one, Bhatti, you always see the while you wear bronchoscope, your eyes should be always on the pulse oximeter. Okay? When the pulse oximeter is normal, you can proceed. Again, don't proceed the bronchoscope without seeing the structure. It is not. Some people know how to develop the social and spatial awareness, anatomical structures. See, like a bronchoscope is, you need to know the structures, know the anatomy, spatial orientation, right, left orientation, structures, disease, all these things, I think your training will give you. That is the reason why we'll make people to attend the training. Once they're with us for a training, I think they're not convinced it is not that much invasive. Once they got boost, I think they can slowly started doing the bronchoscopy. That is why I think many people in India, they are doing excellent bronchoscopy. I can quote them. And they are doing yeoman service to that part of the world.
Sir, there is a question in the chat box. May I read that, sir? It is about the bronchoscopy training workshops. How frequently do you hold bronchoscopy training workshops?
Usually it happens once in one year, but 1.5 year or something like that. This year we kept actually, whether you believe it or not, somewhere around June to July. The last three days of July, like that and all. It has been appeared in Indian Pediatrics also. It postponed, and we usually announce everything in Indian Pediatrics. We get concurrence from IAP, and it will be conducted in Chennai. Invariably, in the Kanchi Kamakoti Child Trust Hospital, because we have initially myself along with Dr. Balachandran, Dr. L. Subramaniam, under the leadership of SOMO, who started this program in ICH, Government Hospital. And off late, I have been retired from the service, but the people who are working in the ICH, I am telling you, they are very good. And my friend Sarath Balaji is there, Madam Hildarsi is there, Dr. Kalpana is there. They are also doing excellent work like us. And anything, that's the reason why we keep continuing this program at least once in 2 years by proper announcement in Indian Pediatrics. You can make your youngsters, identify the youngsters who are useful to the society. And then you tell them, be in touch with us. And we definitely, with a 7-day program, even people attended in a program in the abroad, they say that I saw and I come, I not even touch the bronchoscope. And we outdo even, we make them to use the bronchoscope by their own. And sometimes we also give some live demonstration, and we will also allow them to do bronchoscope along with that. Initially, let them take out the bronchoscope. After that, they initially go up to nasal cavity, like that and all. We train. At one point of time, they may be so confident they will do bronchoscope. Only thing is, when you started doing bronchoscopy, keep anesthetist initially along with you. And again, I'm telling you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Bala, our secretary.
So it's a privilege for us to have Vijayashayan sir for our Meet the Doyens meeting. Full credit to IAP Calicut for selecting the speaker as well as the topic. I have special regards and respect for Vijayashayan sir. I first met him during our state pedicon at Kottayam. Since then, he had been here for 3 to 4 times and was lucky to have his book on bronchoscopy. Thank you for gifting that. And last year also I had lucky enough to attend the one-day workshop at Cochin. Our Tamil Nadu teachers are all dear to us, just like the dermatology trio of Vijay Bhaskar sir, Anandan sir, and madam, I forgot her name. For pediatric pulmonology also, we have the trio of Vijay Shagaran sir, Gauri Shankar sir, and Dr. Soma Shivalan. Whenever they come together. We had a Respicon at Kottayam 2 years back. They've given a wonderful lecture then. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, very much. It was very interesting. You showed the normal variation as well as the very rare disease of Diffoi. Diffoi, no, sir?
Diffoi. Yes. Actually, it's a very rare thing.
First time hearing.
Yes. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Very nice. I have seen a galaxy of people in front of me. Dr. Narayanan, Chennir Sridhar, Harik Kumar, Balchandra sir, Ashraf, Ajay, Anand, Doshi, and Dr. Chachananda Kaur, and Suresh Kumar, Nizal, and I think Roy, Sainath, I don't know. Sainath is also there. I don't know how to word. He's such a, we have a lot of interest in bronchoscopy. We'll be doing a lot of bronchoscopy. Ravi is there, Ranjan is there, and Jijo is there. Jijo, I couldn't just earlier seen, initially I could not see Magesh, Anuja, all these Krishna Mohan, I think all the Dr. Subramanian, everybody is there. I'm very, very happy. And I think it's something like attending more than a conference. Even in the conference, you may not get such a satisfaction, because here the targeted people join with us. More than that, some people may be very free. That's the reason why it isn't. I especially send such on the comment, because he is also very kind enough to grace the occasion with all your busy schedule and all. And Roy is there, and something I left out, Rani is there, and everybody is like there. Ranjit, I think, Krishna Mohan, once again, Narayanan, I'll thank all of you for inviting me for the seminar. Thank you, one and thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. With that comment, with the permission of the chair, Dr. Sachi, we are closing this. This before going to the to Dr. Nihas, I was not fortunate to. Today evening, I called Krishna Mohan and asked him to say a single word about you. Then he said, he's the most humble and gentle human being.
Thank you very much.
And he's approachable to all of us at any time. I realized that by seeing your first slide, sir, because your email ID and mobile number are written there. Thank you, sir, for that excellent session. As Dr. Sachi, Narayanan, Bala, and everyone of us said, there are a lot of messages to the general practitioners, medical teachers, pediatricians, even the respiratory physicians, a session from tuberculosis to the embolization. Thank you for that wonderful session, sir. Over to Dr. Nihas for a word of thanks.
Thank you, Vijay, sir, for that nice session, going through all the series of cases through your experience. Thank you, sir, for coming to Calicut and delivering this talk for us. Thank you, Sachi, sir, for sharing this session. And sir, he's always been close to all of us. Thank you, sir, for coming again to Calicut. Thank you, Narayan, sir, Bala, sir, Andhrakeshan, sir, Ramesh, sir, getting their time in between and coming to most of the programs of IP Calicut. Thank you all of you, and thank you all seniors, teachers, my dear friends, and all others who joined this meeting. Thank you all. We'll be having our next session coming on Friday. The session is by Dr. PSN Manon, sir. This is the next session coming on next Friday. That is the newborn screening, newborn thyroid screening. Where do we go from here? That is on Friday, 8 p.m. I invite all of you for this meeting. Thank you all for coming today. Thank you, Vijayashekhar sir, again. Thank you. Thank you, Narayan sir, and Bala sir, everyone who come, Sachi sir, Ramesh sir, and Antikeshwar sir. Thank you. Thank you for this meeting and all others who helped us in conducting this series. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. My electricity has gone, so I am in darkness.
Okay. Good night. Good night.
Okay. Good night. Good night, all of you. Okay.